The next stop is Avenue J.
Let's go straight to today's topic. Today's topic is absolutely fascinating. I have to tell you, I spent way too much time reading about this, and I have no idea how this lecture is going to go. I'm pretty sure that there is nobody else on the entire internet who has given a lecture on this person, Sarah, the wife of Shabbetai Tsvi. I'm pretty sure this is the first, perhaps the last lecture ever to be given on the internet about this person. But I think, you know, it's such a fascinating discussion. There is actually a book, which we'll discuss later, that has been written on women and the messianic movement of Shabbetai Tsvi and a later later figure, Jacob Frank. And I think there's a lot of really useful scholarship that we can derive from this woman's brief but very eventful life. And I'm hoping that you'll agree with me that this is a fascinating topic. Let's go straight to the material, though. So first we have to give some background, because this is about a woman who was known primarily as the spouse of someone else. She doesn't have any specific claim to fame on her own, although she does have a rather checkered and somewhat racy past. But she's primarily known through her husband, the infamous Shabbetai Tsvi. So let's just spend a little bit of time talking about who this man was, and then we'll proceed more to discuss Sarah, his wife. Shabbetai Tsvi, here, this is actually believed to be a rather accurate reproduction of his physiognomy. An actual witness to, or someone who met Shabbetai Tsvi, was responsible for creating this piece of art. Not Jewish, as you can see. There's some Hebrew writing in the background here, clearly not written by someone who is Hebrew literate. But we have lots of descriptions of his face that meet these requirements. In particular, he's known for having an exceptionally round beard, that every hair of his beard was like perfectly, not trimmed, but just naturally grew in that kind of desirous ovoid shape. So this is probably what he looked like. Now, who was this individual? He was born in Smyrna, Izmir, in 1626. By all accounts, a brilliant individual, tremendous Torah scholar, who knew a phenomenal amount of both written and oral Torah. By the age of 12, he had outgrown all of his teachers. He could no longer have a conventional teacher. And at a very young age, he was introduced to Kabbalah, in particular two sources that we're going to revisit later in today's lecture. He was known to be a very beautiful individual with a lovely singing voice, and he was very charming. Many marriages were proposed to him in his youth. He was actually married three times. That's only counting human beings. He was actually once married to a Sefer Torah, which is another incident we'll talk about later. Unfortunately, he probably suffered from what we would call today bipolar personality disorder. In earlier scholarship, he was referred to as manic depressive. He had these incredibly powerful mood swings that would sometimes leave him incredibly elated and a phenomenal orator and very charismatic and attracting many people as he would, you know, speak on Torah topics for hours at a time. And then at other times he would be plunged to the depths of despair. So he would alternate between these periods of tremendous elation and very public and very charismatic, very gregarious. He called these periods illuminations, when he felt like he was literally inspired by the Spirit of God. And at some points he claimed that during these illuminations he could, for example, levitate, perform various magical acts and so on. Obviously tremendously unstable, and other times he would sink to the lowest depths of despair, full of self-loathing, and, you know, really be hard on himself. Through a rather interesting series of events, including a near-death experience, he slowly began to view himself with a rather exaggerated sense of grandeur, a full-fledged delusion that was exacerbated when he ran into this individual, Nathan of Gaza, who became his prophet, who would sort of like in a John the Baptist style form of preaching, travel around Europe discussing Shabbetai Tsvi and his tremendous potential. And ultimately, of course, as I'm sure you're aware, he revealed him as the Messiah, as Mashiach, the long-awaited Redeemer of the Jews that would come to collect Jews from all over Europe and the world, in fact, and bring them into the land of Israel, where they would reinstitute a temporal Jewish authority, end world poverty, and really everything would be wonderful after the arrival of Mashiach. Popularity of Shabbatai Tzvi is a matter of some scholarly debate, but there's no question that the announcement that the Mashiach had come in 1665 totally electrified the Jewish world. And there were numerous examples of huge populations of Jews literally selling all their worldly belongings, their homes and so on, and packing up and moving to Constantinople to be there when Shabbatai Tzvi presented himself to the Ottoman Turk, the Grand Vizier, who at that time ruled Israel, and then came to claim Jerusalem and then would institute the final apocalypse of the Jews. As you would imagine, the movement ended very badly, and Shabbatai Tzvi ended up converting to Islam, and the vast majority of his Jewish followers abandoned him at that point, dejected, and returned to their homes, humiliated, abject, depressed, and it had important long-term consequences for the development of heterodox movements in Judaism as well. A small number of his followers chose to remain with him, continuing to believe that his conversion to Islam was actually part of the unfolding of the messianic drama, and they constituted a unique kind of Judeo-Muslim sect called the Dunme, who exist up to the present day in parts of Syria. Here's an interesting, this is from a prayer book that is at the height of his illuminations. It shows him seated with the crown of Tzvi above him and various angels, and here he is sitting with the representatives of the 12 tribes, and they're discussing Torah in a manner reminiscent of the Talmudic discussions of the afterlife. So he maintained actually a significant underground following, not only of Dunme, but also of Sabbatean Jews, that is, Jews primarily in Europe at this point, who believed that, this was somehow part of the plan. Shabbatai Tzvi really was Mashiach. We're not exactly sure what it means, but we've got to stick close to him. And although they were shunned and really hunted down by the Jewish establishment, they nevertheless did not go completely underground. And right up into the 20th century, there are examples of Sabbateans in parts of Europe, really up until the Holocaust, really. So it's a fascinating story in itself. I have given a full lecture on Shabbatai Tzvi that is available on the web, and I encourage you to review it if you'd like to see it. We will come back to the last part of his chapter shortly, well, towards the end of this lecture, but I wanted to give the overview of it and before we squeeze in Sarah. So any arguments, questions, debate? That's a great question. What gave Natan that authority? I think it's a whole confluence of factors. One is the fact that Shabbatai Tzvi was really a brilliant individual. We're not talking, most of the modern scholarship does not portray Shabbatai Tzvi as some kind of evil, diabolical person trying to distort Jewish values. He was mentally ill. He was a brilliant individual, deeply learned. His Kabbalistic learning was phenomenal, and good-looking and charismatic and a positive speaker. And it was easy to see, or at least to question, maybe this is Taka the person. Maybe this is really Mashiach. And we have many, many interesting stories of how figures much more prominent than Natan of Gaza who went for it, at least temporarily. One example I think is fascinating. the Taz, the great Turei Zahav, commentator on the Shulchan Aruch, very, very well regarded figure. I mean, this is one of the main commentaries on the Shulchan Aruch. He was interested enough in the story of Shabbetai Tsvi that he sent his son to check it out. He said, please go and examine this guy and let's see if he's for real. And the son came back. It might have been the son-in-law. I can't remember exactly. But he came back, and then he gave a detailed report as to what he saw in Shabbatai Tzvi's court. And the story is that the Taz was listening and listening, and then finally at one point he said, wait a second, what did you just say? Well, and the son says, we were sitting on these Persian strata carpets. And he says, oh, how was he sitting? And he said, well, he was sort of sitting cross-legged. And he says, oh, that's it. He's not Mashiach. He said, how do you know? He says, because we have this, you know, this, we're talking to the commentator on the Shulchan Aruch. There is a halacha that a dignified person does not sit cross-legged. It's just, you know, you wouldn't see the chief rabbi of Israel sitting cross-legged on the floor. It's not Mashiach. But the, and that's, I think, an interesting story. And I have another cool story to tell you. But the fact that he would take it so seriously indicates that someone of the authority of the Taz would at least investigate it. Shows you the depth of the story. The other story that I'd like to tell you, I think it involves the Stipler Gaon, but I'm not sure. I've heard it in different people's names. But you know, in Jerusalem, they have this unique mental illness. It actually has a name. It's called the Jerusalem Syndrome, where people go to Eretz Yisrael, they go to Yerushalayim, and you know it's a spiritual vortex. It's just the air is fraught with religious energy. And you see not just Jews, you see Christians carrying life-size crosses, and you see Japanese people with massive cameras and all kinds of things that, you know, why do you do those things? And so regularly people, you know, have these delusions that they are Jesus or King David or John the Baptist or Moses. You know, it happens that they and so they have, I believe it's in Shari Tzedek, an actual wing for sufferers of Jerusalem syndrome. So the story goes, I'm not sure how true it is, but there was one guy in there who said he was the Jewish Mashiach, and he seemed perfectly stable in every way, very normal, got along with everybody, gave a shiur in the cafeteria, you know, daf yomi, everyone, you know, and after a while, some of the doctors were saying, you know, gee, this guy's pretty convincing, you know, he's real. I mean, people are going to him for shilas. Maybe he is Mashiach. So they went, and I think it was to the Stipler, they asked the question, you know, is it possible that we have Mashiach in our psychiatric wing? So he sent them back and says, I want the same kind of thing as the Taz said. I want a detailed report of everything he does for the next 3 days. So the doctors went and they did this and they came back to him and they gave a really detailed, you know, like reading the medical charts. He did this, then he did this, then he did this. And at one point he said, and then he signed the release form, and the I think it was a Stipler said, wait, where did he get the pen? And they thought, and they said, well, he took it from the nurse's station. He said, oh, that's not Mashiach. Because there's no way that Mashiach would steal even the ink from a pen without getting permission first. Okay, funny story. Anyway, so it really was, I mean, scholars do debate how deep was the attachment to Shabbatai Tzvi, but there's no question that it was significant. Okay. And we saw this picture here. Shall we go on? Yes, okay, let's go on. Now, what do we know about Sarah? This is the only picture I could find of her, which it really does look Jewish, because here's Natalie Portman, Queen Padme, you see, and the hairstyle is shockingly similar, right? We can do that again. There we go. Jewish actress and Sarah. Anyways, so what do we know about Sarah? She has a mysterious background. It's fairly clear that she was orphaned at an early age in the Khmelnytsky rebellion that I'll show you in the next set of slides. There are a lot of scandalous rumors about her youth before she married Shabbatai Tzvi. Some of them may be entirely true. Some of them may be simply salacious rumors that are circulated by enemies of Shabbatai Tzvi who were, you know, legion, especially after he converted to Islam. There are many detractors of Shabbatai Tzvi. By the way, I should point out that Shabbatai Tzvi was one of those rare Jewish religious figures whose fame went beyond the boundaries of the Jewish community. This is someone who was well known throughout the Christian world as well, because they were very interested in, oh, wait a second, you know, if the Jewish Messiah is here, what does that mean for us, right? Is it the same guy? You know, things like that. So they're very interested. There are a lot of Christian accounts of the whole Shabbetai Tsvi story. It's also relevant to discuss the scandalous rumors, because one of the key factors of Shabbatai Tzvi's messiahship was a high degree of antinomianism, meaning a high degree of reversing accepted laws. You know, he made a point, it was actually very central to his theology, that since he was here as the Messiah, the old prohibitions were now permitted, and things that may have been permitted would now be prohibited. He made a big deal, for example, out of things like abolishing fast days and proclaiming them as feast days. Now that Mashiach is here, you know, the 9th of Av is now a feast day. Actually, he started with the 10th of Tevis. It was a little easier to get away with that one. You know, Judaism has a tremendous number of restrictions regarding marital partners and regarding, you know, with whom, what place, what time, things like that. And all of that was out the window. Shabbatai Tzvi himself is a little bit problematic. He clearly had some very troubled personal attitudes to marital relationships. His first two weddings, for example, were not consummated, and only Sarah was he intimate with. But his followers were all over the map. His followers were seeking opportunities to, for example, engage in prohibited relationships, incestuous relationships, adulterous relationships, and this was considered a tikkun. That was the actual word that Shabbatai Tzvi would use, that this is kind of like a repair of what used to be prohibited. Now that he is present, it has been permitted. This, of course, really helped with the membership drive, because they were able to get a lot more people in that way. But at any rate, so it would fit. Sarah's personal behaviors would fit with that. Also, one last note, it's a little jumping ahead from the class, but the possibility that she had loose morals before she met him would actually attract her to him, because there's an important prophetic passage in Hosea that refers to the prophet taking a wife who has a checkered past. And so he would have seen that as like a fulfillment of this prophetic teaching in himself. Now, some scholars opine, based on the limited sources we have and the highly polemic sources we have, that perhaps Sarah was the instigating factor in having him pronounce himself as Mashiach. It's very difficult to assert that based on the highly tendentious nature of the biographical sources. She may have just been along for the ride. Although there are some early scholars who say that the whole problem is really Sarah's, that Sarah pushed him to do it. I personally don't find that very convincing. But there's no question that Sarah's activity as his wife had a profound impact on neo-Sabbatean movements like that led by Jacob Frank. And I would tender, by the time we get to the end of this class, you'll either agree vociferously or disagree, you know, violently with me, that I would say that her role in the entire story of Shabbatai Tzvi had a significant impact on the changing perception of the role of women in Jewish culture, for reasons that I hope to make clear. Okay, let's go past Natalie Portman. Okay, there we go. So let's go to Mr. Wright's point, her childhood and youth. So she was orphaned at an early age. We do have some sense of her birthday, which would have meant that she was probably 8 years old when she lost her parents. We're not entirely sure if it was both her parents, but it was certainly at least her mother, and she was separated from her father. Again, we have several different accounts of her life that have contradictory details. The reason for her orphan status is the tragic Ukrainian rebellion of 1648-49 that occurred primarily in the right bank region of Ukraine, the so-called right bank because the Dnieper River flows south, and so this is the right-hand side And this is heavily populated by Jews, really from the 16th century. It becomes like Boca Raton. I mean, Jews are just all flooding there. I thought that was funny, but it becomes like a really popular destination for Jews. I mean, look at these town names, Berdichev, Ternopil, Kamenets-Podilsk. These are all, you know, very important names in the Jewish shtetl world. And pogroms, which swept through the right bank Ukraine in the mid-17th century, were absolutely horrific. And they dwarfed anything that had happened, certainly since the Crusades, possibly even going back to the 1390 pogroms in Spain, or perhaps even the Beis HaMikdash. Terrible, terrible pogroms. They were led primarily by these individuals known as Cossacks. The term is used in different contexts in Russian history, but in this context, we're talking about these Ukrainian peasants who were largely runaways from their farms. In the right bank Ukraine, serfs were owned, not quite like slaves, but they were attached to the land, and they were owned by their master. And there are all kinds of discrimination applied to them, economic exploitation to be sure, and many of them simply gave up and they went and they lived in these cowboy-like encampments around the rapids of the Dnieper River. There they lived kind of like a freebooting cowboy-style lifestyle where they went raiding Turkish lands to steal plunder and to bring back Ukrainian slaves that had been taken by the Turks and so on. In Ukrainian civic mythology, they're heroic. They're considered like the Wild West kind of freedom-loving individuals. For Jews, they are considered generally quite negatively, because when they finally had a large political uprising under this man, Bohdan Khmelnytsky, this political uprising was primarily designed to overthrow Polish leadership of the region, but the Jews were involved in the economic structure of right bank Ukraine under the Poles, and the Jews suffered heavily in the violence that ensued. It's difficult to get a good estimate of how many Jews were killed in the pogroms of 48-49. Reasonable estimates, though, put it about 50 to 60,000 Jews, which is a massive, massive number in that context. You will see, if you read some of the older literature, numbers as high as 250,000, which is kind of absurd because there weren't anywhere near that many Jews living there at the time, but nevertheless, it was an extremely brutal and awful time. One thing I forgot to mention, the rapids are here near the town of Dnipropetrovsk. Dnipropetrovsk is an interesting city. It used to be called Yekaterinoslav, but they thought that Yekaterinoslav was too hard to pronounce, so they changed it to Dnipropetrovsk. That's a joke I use often, you know. Should I say it again? Would it be funnier if I said no? Probably not. Okay, so here we go, past these. So she was orphaned in these pogroms, and she made her way to Germany. This is an interesting picture of, this is Bertha Pappenheim, very important mid-century German Jewish activist, dressed in the clothing of her 17th century ancestor, Glückel of Hameln. She took this photograph in these clothes in order to like give you a sense of probably that's more or less what Glückel would have looked like. It is her direct ancestor, after all, posing. Glückel of Hameln, who lived at this same time, describes how her family took in many refugees from the Ukrainian pogroms, and apparently young Sarah was one of these refugees. She was not staying directly with Glückel, but we know that she fit within that group. And then she began a period of wandering. She was with her brother, who ended up falling into the trade of tobacco sorting. Tobacco had just been introduced to the European continent, and so they would bring leaves, and I guess he would sort them by, you know, menthol or low tar and things like that. Not a very high-paying position. And then she spent some time basically wandering. You imagine she's about 8 or 9 years old, and she wandered to Amsterdam, to Italy, and so on. Now, in Italy, she began to circulate these stories, and this is around the time when Shabbetai Tsvi's fame is rising, that she was destined to be the wife of the Messiah. She ended up making her way to Egypt. Whether or not she was summoned there or not is not clear. And Shabbetai Tsvi married her there in 1664. This is just 2 years before he apostatizes to Islam, and probably in the home of his major supporter, Raphael Joseph, a major figure in the Egyptian Jewish community. Now, at this time, there's a lot of fascination about Shabbetai Tsvi, and so there are several published accounts that speak about his wife. There are four distinct stories associated with her and her background, and I'd like to just, you know, I'm not going to go into too many of the details, but let's look at the common elements in all four of these versions. The first thing that you see in the versions of her life is that she was raised at some point as a Christian. Some versions have her adopted after her parents were killed in the pogroms. Others say she was abducted by a Polish nobleman who wanted to marry her off to his son. Another version has that she was taken into a convent after her parents were killed. We have no way of evaluating between these, but there's probably a common thread there that she was sheltered at some point by a Christian sponsor. Then, as the stories go, she was visited by her late father. The spirit of her father came to her. In some versions, he bodily transports her from one country to another overnight and deposits her in a cemetery. In other versions, she is visited by a vision of her father, and she follows him into a cemetery. But the common theme of the late father, kind of Hamlet-like, appearing to her is in all of the versions. There in the graveyard, she is given some mystical instruction, sometime by her father, sometime by her grandfather, but she is read her destiny, that is, that she's supposed to marry the Mashiach. And finally there, she is given some kind of magical coat of skin, which is rumored, and this is something that the Christian writers actually are quite fascinated by, which is rumored to be the coat of skin that Eve made, that Chava made for Adam. It's kind of weird. That's not exactly the way we read those midrashim and so on, but you know, you have to take it with a grain of salt. Apparently, she was given some kind of garment that was, you know, hearkening back to biblical times, and in some versions, it's inscribed with all kinds of Kabbalistic incantations, names of angels and things like that, but she has some kind of glorious, you know, costume that she carries about with her. At this point, we pick up her story where we really know something about her, because now it's like part of the media coverage. She goes to Egypt. She marries Shabbetai Tsvi. He may have sent for her, again, hearing that there's this crazy lady in Leghorn who is claiming to be his predestined wife. That's like exactly the kind of thing that would appeal to Shabbetai Tsvi. Or maybe she just showed up and said, you know, this is the story, and it fit with everything, so there we go. Now, Shabbetai Tsvi himself had a difficult relationship with women, so it's interesting to see that he had such a positive relationship with Sarah. This is a picture of him, which is probably not accurate, but I really like it, so I included it there anyways. He had two prior marriages, one of which was set up before he showed signs of mental illness, but from all accounts, they were never consummated. He never had any relationship with them, and as a result, he divorced them. As I think I mentioned, when in one of his illuminations, one of his periods of sort of manic activity, he actually organized a marriage between himself and a Torah scroll. So if you want to include that in the third wife category, I don't know, but he did so. That's also an example of his antinomianism. He also, at many times, placed himself in really unacceptable temptation with young unmarried women. Apparently, there was quite a draw. There were many young women who were attracted to his court, and he often would spend time inappropriately in yichud with them, although by all accounts, the relationships were entirely platonic. This is in great distinction to his followers who, you know, would pride themselves on pretty much every forbidden relationship you can imagine. Maybe not everything you can imagine. This is New York, 21st century. But most of the things you can imagine were going on, and they were proud of it because they saw it as a tikkun, as a reparation. Again, you have to think of it in the sense of, you know, Judaism has a lot of restrictions. There's a lot of thou shalt nots. And with Mashiach here, it's kind of like loosening all the restrictions. Now everything goes, and in fact, the reintroduction of that which was prohibited was considered a religious act under Shabbetai Tsvi. He called these things the tikkunim, the repairs of the world. Now, even though Shabbetai Tsvi himself may have been quite chaste, his neo-Sabbatean followers were definitely not, including in particular Jacob Frank, who was extremely popular in Poland in the following century. And there's a direct line of influence from Shabbetai Tsvi to Jacob Frank. The major differences, however, were that Jacob Frank ultimately converted to Christianity rather than Islam. But we also have a rather bizarre story there with this antinomian activity. So when Sarah comes on the scene, he marries her, and he has a relationship with her that is qualitatively different than any relationship he has ever had with a woman before, and it lasts to the end of her life. Well, not exactly. They divorced, but then he remarried her. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Yes, please. Maybe he did prohibit. He prohibited reading from the Sefer Torah, like a Torah scroll, when you have a printed chumash, when you have a printed book, which is definitely not the custom. But it's, you have to think of it kind of like, you have to imagine that a printed chumash in the 1660s, that's like an iPad, you know? That's like saying we will no longer read from the Sefer Torah. We are now super modern. Look at this. We're going to read right from this. It's got vowels in it, you know, everything. And this was like sort of a modernizing approach that I find that rather cool. What about the role of women? Let's get a little deeper past the individual story of Sarah. What about the impact of this woman? There are some fascinating things going on. First of all, there's a whole book on this that I really enjoyed reading by Ada Rapoport-Albert. She's an English scholar who works on a lot of Hasidic thought and has written quite a few really interesting books. She wrote this book, Women and the Messianic Heresy of Shabbatai Tzvi. There's also a large section on Jacob Frank. It really should be both of them, but it's mainly Shabbatai Tsvi. And this was a huge breakthrough because, when you read the magnum opus on the life of Shabbatai Tsvi, you read Gershom Scholem's fantastic 900-page biography, there is literally no index entry for Sarah. Even though he does discuss her quite a bit, and I eventually did find her misindexed under the last name Tsvi. Tsvi is not her last name, that's her husband's middle name. But nevertheless, Sarah just doesn't get the kind of attention that she deserves, and this is a book that I think addresses that in retrospect. She doesn't have any more details to tell us about Sarah because there's no more sources than what Gershom Scholem had, but she does have some fascinating analysis, and I'd like to turn to that for a few minutes. First of all, Shabbatai Tsvi himself had a really progressive agenda vis-a-vis women. He actually was quite a challenging thinker when it came to women's rights. Now, it went in hand with all of his tikkunim and let's change everything and let's make everything permitted, but he really was passionate about giving women more authority and power in Judaism, as I shall show you right now. Why not? I'll jump ahead to this slide right now. This is from one of his first oratories that was recorded by a Christian observer. He writes, or he speaks, "As for you wretched women, great is your misery, for on Eve's account you suffer agonies in childbirth. What is more, you are in bondage to your husbands and can do nothing small or great without their consent," and so on and so forth. "Give thanks to God then that I have come to the world to redeem you from all your sufferings, to liberate you and make you as happy as your husbands, for I have come to annul the sin of Adam. He goes on at length. What exactly is this sin of Adam? So you recall, of course, you know, the whole story with the forbidden fruit and so on. And Eve is punished with pain in childbirth. And she is punished also with a degree of subjugation to her husband. That's fairly explicit in the text. Exactly how you read it is something that's beyond her scope. But there is an idea that she will be somehow drawn after him. He, on the other hand, will have to eat his bread by the sweat of his brow, and you know the earth will be cursed and things like that. It reminds me of a very funny story. Please forgive me. This is therapeutic for me to tell you these things. When my kids were little, and I used to give night classes much like this, and I would read them bedtime stories. Actually, I would make up bedtime stories until I fell asleep, but I would tell them bedtime stories. Then I would say, okay, I've got to go give my lecture. So my kids would say when they're very young, especially the one who said Depths of Despair, but why do you have to go give your lecture? You know, can't you tell us more stories? And I said, oh, I'm sorry. It's the curse of Adam HaRishon that I have to go. I have to make my bread. I have to go out and work at night. And my kids used to say, ooh, that curse of Adam HaRishon. He's like all upset about it. And they really felt it in their kishkes, you know. Okay, anyways. So the curse, the whole idea here is that in the curse of Adam HaRishon, he's speaking directly to the idea, the aspect of that curse that is women's subjugation to men. And in the context of like liberating, he uses the word liberate here, right? The idea of liberating the women, of freeing them, the great tikkun is now women are equal to men. And you can bet that when he's pulling out Chumashim and everyone is reading from Chumashim, he makes a big point that women get to have aliyahs, just like men do. Women count in a minyan, just like men do. A lot of things that you might see in a non-Orthodox synagogue today, you saw in Shabbatai Tzvi's shul as well, because he was very into this liberation from the sin of Adam. So why would Shabbatai Tzvi place this so high on his agenda? In this regard, I think Ada Rapoport-Albert did something really brilliant. She studied what Shabbatai Tzvi studied to see where is he getting this idea, because it is pretty radical for 17th century. And it's fascinating because his Kabbalistic studies were based almost entirely on two books. One is the Zohar, of course, the great classic of Kabbalistic teachings. But the other was an interesting kind of work called Sefer Hakana. And the Sefer Hakana is basically a kind of a dialogue between a rabbi and a student. We use this format quite frequently in Jewish literature. You've seen it in the Letters of Ben Uziel by Shamshon Raphael Hirsch, for example. Dialogue between a rabbi and a student, where the student poses all kinds of theological conundrums to the rabbi, at which point the rabbi answers them. So the answers are interesting, but what's really fascinating are the questions, because a book like this, a very pious book, is nevertheless an opportunity to state in print, you know, nagging doubts, uncertainties about Judaism that can have some resolution. And we're still publishing these things. I think I saw one in the Five Towns Jewish News a while ago about something, what to say when they ask, right? So the answers are good, but the questions are even better. So if Ada Rapoport-Albert studied the questions in this medieval work, and they are just devastating questions about why don't women have aliyahs, why don't women count for a minyan, why is there a distinction between time-bound mitzvot and non-time-bound mitzvot? Really, you know, penetrating questions that would fit very well in a 21st century class on Judaism and women. Fascinating questions. And whatever the answers were, Shabbatai Tzvi was clearly more moved by the questions. He came up with answers which were radically different than the traditionalist Sefer Hakana, but nevertheless, he was clearly influenced by the kinds of questions that were asked in that scenario. Another thing that she points out in her book, which I think is quite fascinating, and this is sort of like the theme for me this year, because I spent so much time thinking about it. A lot of Shabbatai Tzvi's followers were undoubtedly descendants of the converso families from Spain, and the Portuguese mass expulsion. And you recall, we spoke about this all the way back in September and October, right? People like Uriel da Costa, who are, you know, really very enthusiastic, well-meaning Jews who want to reconnect to their tradition, but because they did not have the opportunity to grow up with Judaism as a culture, living in the Iberian Peninsula, then when they come to Judaism, they're coming to something, once they got out of Spain, that, you know, it doesn't seem the same as the way they imagined it. And there's a sort of cognitive dissonance, a gap that erupts between their perception of this amazingly beautiful, meaningful, deep religion, and then how Jews actually behave in the street. That is, by the way, the curse of all Balei Tshuva is, you know, you think that everybody who is Orthodox is really moral and ethical and does it exactly according to Taryag Mitzvos. Oy Vesmir, it still hurts me when I see that, not like so. But at any rate, so these converso families, these converso Jews, are trying to reconnect to their Judaism. They have lingering impressions of what Judaism should be like based on their extensive Christian upbringing, and they're not satisfied with the traditional status quo. Shabbetai Tsvi is offering them what they would think is like a more intellectually appropriate way to access Judaism, and that generated quite a bit of enthusiasm as well. It would also, one would think, generate enthusiasm among women. So, taken together, Shabbatai Tzvi's approach to women, as exemplified in his wife Sarah's behavior in particular, is something that would have garnered quite a bit of support, one would think, among the female followers. And now I should go back to her life specifically. Okay, right, we read that. Let's go on. Right. So let's go to the debacle. What happens after the end, because there's some interesting things related to Sarah here. This is a great sort of, it's a broadsheet published in German that sort of tells the story of Shabbatai Tzvi. I've only reproduced the top half of it. The bottom half is basically text, and you can see that each one of the panels here has a number. And in the text, it's kind of like an annotated cartoon. It tells you exactly what's happening in that picture. And you have to place yourself within the 17th century context where, you know, complex pieces of information like this is kind of like the equivalent of a New York tabloid paper, right? Where it's expensive to produce large numbers of them, but you can make a big one and put it in a street on one of those round posts, and you can walk up to it and you can look at it, and it can be really like, you know, like a full TV episode to read the whole story here. So let's just look at a few of these slides here. Here's the first one where Shabbatai Tzvi is described riding into Constantinople, about to meet the Grand Vizier and to make his request for the land of Jerusalem. And here he is marching into town with great pomp and circumstance, appearing before the Grand Vizier over there on the right. Here he is, he's lifting his hand saying, "Okay, ich bin da, I'm here, I would like to have Jerusalem, please." The Grand Vizier says, "How about this, why don't we arrest you? And we'll threaten to cut off your head unless you decide to become Muslim." So Shabbatai Tzvi says, "Okay, let's do the Muslim thing." Here he is. They take off his cloak, and it doesn't show up very well in this picture. But the caption reads that a whole bunch of hard biscuits fall out of his robe, because that's the way that he used to practice a lot of fasting. And so they say he actually used to secrete lots of biscuits in his robe to assist him in that. I don't think there's any reason to believe that's true, but nevertheless, it is kind of a funny story that illuminates the mindset of the author of this broadsheet. Then he gets new Muslim clothes, and now he's going to be a good Ottoman. And here we have Sarah also getting new Muslim clothes, and she joins him in his apostasy to Islam and lives with him for quite some time as one of the new Muslim followers of Shabbatai Tzvi. Now, in those final years, we have some fascinating developments with her life. She actually has a son by him. They name him appropriately Yishmael, right? Because that name is not very well used among Jews, although there is a very famous rabbi named Yishmael in the Talmud. And Mordechai after Shabbatai Tzvi's father. Later, in 1671, probably in one of these depressive stages, he grows disgusted with Sarah, and he repudiates her in a very profound and public way, rather humiliates her. He speaks of getting rid of her as a leper getting rid of his leprosy. And he divorces her, but shortly thereafter, she gives birth to their daughter. So he reconsiders, and he remarries her again. This is, you know, you see this kind of pattern is common for Shabbatai Tzvi. She dies shortly thereafter in 1674. Guessing her age, she's probably about 35 at this point. Shabbatai Tzvi lived till 1676. He was 49, so you can see the gap in their ages is about a dozen years. I'm not precisely sure the date of her birth. But we know that on the whole, she was, with the possible exception of Nathan of Gaza, the most important person in his adult life. Nathan of Gaza, by the way, had tremendous antipathy towards Sarah, and on numerous occasions really tried to keep her far away from Shabbatai Tzvi, perhaps because, you know, she could exert more control over him that Nathan of Gaza did not appreciate. Like, for example, one of the prophecies that Nathan of Gaza used to utter was that Shabbatai Tzvi would choose a wife, and her name would be Rivka Bas Moshe, Rebecca, the daughter of Moshe. And of course, he married Sarah, not Rivka, so Sarah started signing all her letters, the Lady Queen Rivka, son of Moshe, wife of Shabbatai Tzvi. She just took the name over, and Nathan of Gaza was not pleased with this kind of shenanigans, but you get a sense of what might have happened in the court. We don't know much about how he felt after her passing. He definitely went into a deep depression that may have been related to many other things. We know that Shabbatai Tzvi personally did have some rapprochement with his Judaism. The last communication that we have from him was he's imprisoned right now because he fell afoul of the Ottoman authorities. He requested a machzor for the high holidays. He wanted to pray in the Rosh Hashanah liturgy. So we do have some sense that he kind of developed a level of tshuva, wanted to come back, but his death did not permit any further development on those grounds. So when we look at Sarah, Shabbatai Tzvi, and the role of women, we can see that there's a very complex group of phenomena coming together here that include, for example, the challenging new possibilities of women's roles in antinomian religious movements, the importation of new technologies that radically democratize learning, such as the printing of the Chumash, the possibility of re-envisioning traditional religious doctrines in a way that can garner mass support, such as his rereading of the Curse of Adam, and the nagging persistence of Sabbatean movements in many circles, some explicit, like that of Jacob Frank and his daughter Eva Frank, who, somewhat like Shabbatai Tzvi, was an extremely important person in the Frankist messianic movement, although she herself would not participate in any of the relationship antics that her followers engaged in. Not for our discussion tonight, but there's a lot of interesting scholarship on the penetration of Sabbatean ideas into mainstream, widely accepted streams or intellectual currents within Judaism, including thought among very orthodox thinkers like the Ramchal, Rabbi Moshe Chaim Lutzato, who was known to have read Sabbatean books. He himself, of course, was not an adherent of the movement, but he did value Shabbatai Tzvi's thought in certain areas. His main defender and teacher said, "Would you please stop that? You're being hounded across Europe because of these things." And he would say, quoting the Zohar, "But Rabbi, I eat the fruit and discard the peel." Also a great amount of debate over the relationship between Sabbateanism and the flourishing of the Hasidic movement, which also practiced a certain degree of challenging antinomianism towards traditional Talmudic behaviors. So there's really a lot to say about the impact of Sabbateanism on 17th and 18th century Judaism, and I would dare say even contemporary Judaism, particularly when we think about the role of women. Thank you very much for your attention and your endurance. I look forward to seeing you next week. If you applaud now, I can put it on the tape and it sounds good on the internet. Okay, that's very good. Thank you. Next week, really fast.
Stand clear of the closing doors, please.